Good evening. Good evening. I want to encourage those who are out in the lobby or are socializing to find a seat. It's wonderful to be out and be able to connect, isn't it? I'm so thankful that you're here. And for those who are watching online, thank you. Greetings. We are excited for the evening as we have an opportunity to honor Pastor Mike Pless and the long service that he has had here, the faithful service. What I want to do is, since there's some folks in here that are getting situated, and there are folks online that are hopefully coming online, as I want to let you know in just a minute here, I'm going to be giving away some copies of Seasons of a Leader's Life by Dr. Jeff Orge for the online group. Everybody in here received a copy. Y'all got a copy, right? Everybody's good. And then we have some limited copies of Shadow Christians that we're going to give away. This is Dr. Orge's brand new book. So what I want to do is I want to let the folks that are online make sure you're situated, you're able to connect with Google, that's just a hint, and you're ready to go. And I think everybody in here is situated. So what I'd like to do first is I'd just like to pray for us and maybe make some introductions, just some really brief introductions, and then we'll play some games and we'll begin. So if you wouldn't mind, let's just open with a word of prayer. Lord, what an opportunity, God, that we can gather even with safety restrictions and even with technology to honor a man who has weathered tremendous ups and downs, difficulties and joys, pastored a church for years, watched people's lives changed, grown. And we're here to honor Pastor Mike Pless. So we're so thankful that we even have the opportunity. We're thankful for the guests that have come to be a part of this, for those who are online. Lord, I ask that this night would both bring you glory and honor, but also bring us a joy as we seek to celebrate longstanding faithfulness in little places, Lord, that do amazing things for your kingdom. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I think we need to do this. I hope this isn't the only reason you came. But I know for some of you it might be. So here's what we have. So first of all, I'm Pastor Brian Catherman. I pastor Redeeming Life Church here with Pastor Mike Pless, because Good Shepherd Fellowship and Redeeming Life Church have merged, and that has afforded us a fantastic opportunity to allow a pastor to, I'm going to say semi-retire, but officially he's retiring, and we are going to bring him on as a Pastor Emeritus, a position of honor. That allows him to continue to do ministry in the ways that he wants to without all the things that pastors have to do that he doesn't want to. And he has a grand hope for the latter years of his ministry. We've spoke about this some. He's hoping still to minister to the congregation well. Some of you have been walking with him for 200 years, and so you're going to want to continue doing such a thing. And I'm glad that he's here to help us with that. But also, he wants to preach once in a while, and he's still passionate about teaching. And he's hoping that he can pour into others and continue to develop other pastors here in the community so that when he's long gone, no offense, Pastor Mike, but we're all going to be gone. When he's long gone, the kingdom work is still being done in very hard places like Utah. And so that's in part what we're honoring, but we're also hoping to keep him here to continue doing that for at least a little while. And so that's really why we've gathered here, is for Pastor Mike. But we also have a distinguished guest here, which will be introduced a little bit later, but Dr. Orge, who's written two books, many more books, but two that I have in hand. And we have Dr. Josh Seafkow, who will come up in just a moment, too. And we'll get to that in a minute, but we're happy to have these guests here. We have some other guests from the denomination, some other pastors from churches. Welcome. Let's see how we can do here. I have some questions that should afford you an opportunity here in the room. And some of these, we'll have some for online too, but this is an in-the-room question. If you can answer this question correctly, you will receive a copy of Shadow Christians, Making an Impact When No One Knows Your Name by Dr. Jeff Orge. It's brand new. When did this come out, Dr. Orge? I mean, just weeks ago, a couple weeks. November 10th, brand new book. And I've been flipping through the pages a little bit. It's outstanding. So here's our first question. First of all, Pastor Mike started here as the lead pastor in November 1996, right? No. Well, we're going to pretend that he started here in 96, because my answer isn't going to help if he started in 95. Okay, so you said you got ordained in 1996. Is that right? Okay. So we're going to do it this way. In November of 1996, when Pastor Mike was ordained at this church, what was the average price of gasoline in America? Come on. You get one guess, give us your best. $1.29 is wrong. 97 cents is wrong. 79 cents is wrong. It is more than a dollar. This could take a while. 179 is too high. Dollar, what was it? $1.08 is too low. Oh man. $1.59 is too high. $1.15 is too low. $1.49 is too high. $1.25 is really close, but just a little bit too high. $1.21 is just a tad too low. Who just said $1.22? Yay! Good thing we didn't do the 1995. Okay, for those of you who are online, I want to give as many of you as I can a copy of Seasons of a Leader's Life, Learning, Leading, and Leaving Your Legacy, which is a great book. I've really enjoyed this book. I've come back to it many times. It is a helpful book. I have extra copies. If you share the video stream with your social media group, or even provide some kind of comment for your friends to encourage them to watch this evening, and I have enough copies, I will send you a copy. So if you are watching online and you share this, I will send you a copy of this book. Now, I will also send you a copy of Shadow Christians, but you have to be the first person, and our sound booth guy in the shadows, Patrick, is going to watch for me. Are you ready, Patrick? He's giving me a thumbs up. Josiah's back there helping. All right. This is a tricky one, and we're not doing it in the room because none of us would probably, well, one of us would get it. The rest of us would not. If you can be the first person online to, or I guess if you're in the room, you can go online and do this and we'll send you a book. But if you can be the first person to provide the name of the church that Dr. Jeff Orge planted in Oregon many years ago now, when he was a young church planter, and we will accept two names. There are two names. The church has had a name change. If you can be the first one to provide that name, besides the one who planted the church, you probably got it like ingrained, right? You still slip and say it once in a while. Hey, welcome to, oops. They're going to keep an eye out for that, and they're going to give me a thumbs up when somebody does it, but you're probably Googling and figuring it out, and that's okay. We'll come back to the room. All right, I'm going to put this one aside. If you've won a book, you're no longer eligible for a book, because you might win a few of these. And you might not want to answer this one, but if you like a book, you got to play. So the oldest person in the room, if you are over, where do we want to start? 70, and you want to play, stand up. Mike, I got a book for you. It's got something written in it. All right, we got something. It's just taking them a little bit to get up. I thought we had it, but they're up now. They're up. They're on their feet. All right, you think you got it? Oh, you're on your feet. It's game over. You're on your feet. We've done it. All right, 73. Over 73? All right, 74? 75? 76. Oh, Joe's a winner. You know, yeah, he's making his way back down now, safely. Newest person to move to Utah. Newest person to move to the great state of Utah. Who has been here for less than, we'll say 4 years. If you've been here for less than 4 years, stand up. And Patrick's up. Well, that's it. So it's just between you guys. 3 years? You're both up. 2 years? Patrick can't sit down. He's in the, oh, it's the Shorns. You want to do me a favor? Robbie and Meg Shorn. Fantastic. Now, let's go the other way. Let's go the other way. Who has been here in Utah the longest? And Joe, you're out because you already won a book, but it could be you. Who has been here the longest? If you have been in Utah for more, actually, Pastor Mike, how long have you been in Utah? 48 years. If you have been in Utah for more than 48 years, stand up. Whoa, that's not as many as I would have thought. 40, okay. I don't want to embarrass anybody here, so we don't want to get into the age game again. But if you've been here for more than 50 years. Ah, okay, good, we got it. Here comes one that's totally rigged. Sorry, I'm just going to call it what it is. If you are a pastor here in Utah, let's just start with standing up. Let's just do that. If you're a pastor in Utah, on staff at a church, besides Mike, I got a book for you. You can stay down. I know you had a big dinner. I was with you. I have a book for you too, Jared. There's something else, something we'll talk later. There's just you. Come on and get a book. This was a rigged deal. Brent pastors just north of here, and I thought you should probably have one of those because when you pastor in Utah, pretty much this book applies to you. So I have no more books on that front. So did we get a winner on the church name? No. It's kind of awkward. Nobody's finding it, huh?
Maybe ask a question again. We have some new viewers.
Oh, okay. Whoa. That is correct. We have a winner on the online, and hopefully people are sharing it. So the answer was Greater Gresham. He said Baptist Church. You didn't tell me that. Greater Gresham Baptist Church. All right, I think we need to. So we will get you a copy. We'll take care of that and get that to you. I think it would be appropriate now if we turn our attention to a little bit more serious matters, and that is to just talk about legacy and lifetime of service. So I get the joy of working with Pastor Mike every day, but the rest of us, we get to hear a little bit more about that tonight. And so to do that, I've asked Dr. Josh Seafkow. I really like saying Dr. Josh Seafkow. We were roommates in our doctoral program together. Some of you have heard stories. I won't share most of those tonight, but I will share that we encouraged each other on to finish the program. There are some in this room that know this stuff is hard, and if it wasn't for Josh, I'm not sure how well I would have done on campus and off, so I appreciate you, brother. And also, I remember having some conversations with him before this merge ever came to be, where he said, yeah, I have a pastor emeritus. In fact, we might have had that conversation not long after Gateway. And I said, tell me about that, because most of us in Utah probably are not familiar with what a pastor emeritus is or what they do. One of the members of our church was talking with some coworkers trying to explain that, and the coworker said, oh, so it's like being the Queen of England. You don't really do anything except what you want to do, and you're just there. That's about right, actually. That's about right. So we're gonna get a sword out and make Pastor Mike the Queen of England. But I didn't understand what that was like. I didn't understand the benefit or the value of that. And Josh, my friend, said, I have a pastor emeritus, and it's outstanding. It's one of the best moves I've made. The church loves it. I love it. I have my own pastor now because there's someone here. And he talked me through that quite a bit. And then when the merge became a reality or was becoming a reality, I called him up and said, tell me more about that. And it's because of Josh that I was able to go to Mike and say, Mike, I have an idea. You stay in this role, and this is what I think it could look like. And I'm glad for you, Josh, because now I have a pastor, I have a friend, we're working in ministry, and it's absolutely wonderful. But I thought it would be appropriate to hear a little bit more about that from you, and then he's going to introduce Dr. Ward. Come on up, Josh. Let's give this guy a hand. Thank you very much. He came all the way from Georgia. You can use that.
I just want to say what an honor, what a privilege, what a joy it is to stand before you. Our church in Georgia absolutely loves Redeeming Life. We're so grateful for what God is doing here. You have a beautiful facility. We've heard great things. They've sent me here literally just to brag on Jesus, what he's doing through our pastor emeritus, and what he's doing in my life, and what it means, Brother Mike, and to your lovely wife as well. It means you work for free. Isn't that the good news? And that's what I told our pastor emeritus when I pitched the idea to him before I ever went to our church at Flat Creek Baptist Church in Fayetteville. I said, I want to make you pastor emeritus. And he asked the same question you're probably asking tonight. What is it? And not only do you work for free, but you become my pastor. And you become my mentor, and you become my friend. And so every Tuesday, this is pre-COVID now, he's 85 years old. And so during the COVID days, the corona apocalypse, we've just kind of pressed pause on this whole thing. But before all of this, every Tuesday, we'd go out making visits together. We'd just go through the church roll, and we'd fellowship, and we'd go into people's homes. He'd think I should meet them and spend time with them and love on them. And then we'd also just fellowship one-on-one together. I'm walking through school stuff, or I'm walking through life, and two girls, and so I sought wisdom from him. And one of the greatest things that our church saw was a Paul-Timothy relationship taking place. They saw a mentor in my life, someone who was speaking truth into my life, and I'm so grateful that you are going to receive this as a church family, that your pastor is going to have a pastor that he can go to and seek wisdom from and have all those years of experience that you can glean from. What a joy. What a thing to be proud of as a church body that your pastor has a pastor. But I don't want to take too long up here because I know what's in store for tonight. But just to show you a little glimpse of who our pastor emeritus is, he helps us with funerals. He helps us with baptisms. He helps us with preaching. Again, he's just a great man. I know you are as well. Just the time. But I kind of get sick of all the talent that he really does have. Outside of all that stuff, I can't go to literally nursing homes. I go to funeral homes. I'll go to the library. And he is a master painter. And when we started talking about the idea of coming out here as a church family, he said, I want to paint Pastor Mike a gift. And so he has spent coronavirus painting this one painting. Now, the frame we're not proud of. I want you to know that. The frame was to make sure it got here safe and sound. And we don't know your decor, so you do whatever you want. We're not married to the frame. You do whatever you want with it. But this is what he's painted for you. And it's Bill Priester, and he can't be here today. He would be here with me if it wasn't for coronavirus. But he's taken this time to paint this for you and your family. And he hopes these are some of the best days of ministry you've ever had. We love you. We're proud of you. And this all comes from our pastor emeritus. Isn't that a pretty picture? Isn't that pretty? So, Pastor Mike, I want to give you that. And I want to stand and smile and get the picture that we can remember for a while here. There's a lot of social distancing here, so just imagine it. Thank you, Josh. We're so proud of you. We really are. Thanks for... Priester, yep, he put it on there as well for you. And from a man who served at our church for 32 years and continues to do great work, he's available to be a friend, and we just are so proud of you. We really are.
You can tell him I really appreciate this. I grew up in Alabama. My grandparents owned a farm.
Well, we did a little bit of research before we had him painting that. I asked Brian what you were into, so I cheated a little bit. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Absolutely. And I'll tell you just one more story of how you connect, Pastor, and how our speaker tonight connects. And if I can just introduce Dr. Orge at this time as well. It wasn't long ago that I've been at our church for 3 years. And in the first 6 months, we had to make some really tough calls. It was in a situation where we just had to walk through a lot as a church family. And I was in the doctoral program at Gateway Seminary, and we had to have field mentors, and my field mentor was my pastor emeritus. And so I asked my pastor emeritus to sit into a meeting that I was anticipating being one of those meetings as you go into a pastor. This fella doesn't like me much, and I wanted someone in there to see how I handle conflict. And he got in there, and he started pressing in on my family. It was more than principles. It was pressing into who I was as a person, to how my wife looked, to how my children acted. And it was just the mere presence of my pastor emeritus that kept me from doing something really stupid. But also, it was when that fella left and I just prayed for him. I said, I really don't have anything to say, and I'll just pray for you, and I'm sorry you feel that way. And he left. And then turned to my pastor emeritus, and I began to weep. Because I was so wounded. I had no one else to go to. I couldn't take it to my wife. I couldn't talk to it about my children, but I had my pastor right there. And brother, that's what you are to this pastor right here.
Amen.
You are the listening ear. You are his pastor. You are the one that he can go to. He can't bring it to his family. He's going to come to you. And that is a gift that none of our pastors would give away for the world. We are so grateful for this role that we call Pastor Emeritus and that you serve in. But I don't know what I would have done if I wasn't in that program. And if I hadn't made a decision years before to choose to go to Gateway Seminary off a basis of a man who's pastored a church. You can go to a lot of different seminaries, but some have never even pastored a church. You get your mind around that. But I chose Gateway Seminary because I admire the president that was there. And Dr. Jeff Orch, who you've heard, has written books. He's a pastor, he's an author, he's a teacher. He's a leader, he's also a lover of racing, okay? As a barbecue connoisseur. I mean, he's one of our guys. We need to pray this out of him tonight. Maybe we can have a prayer service over him. He's an Oregon Ducks fan, and we can just all be in agreement together. We'll pray that out of him. He reads fiction. He does cheer for the Ducks. He has 3 adult children. He has 4 grandchildren. But here's what I love about Dr. Jeff Orge. He is a man who whispers commands and he shouts example. And that's the best thing that I could say about him tonight, that he whispers commands and he shouts his life by example. He is a wonderful, wonderful, godly man, great leader, and we're delighted to have him tonight. So Dr. Orge, why don't you come and share tonight?
All right, thank you.
Welcome, man.
Appreciate it, brother. Yeah. Well, good evening, everyone. A few months ago, the organizers of tonight's event contacted me, explained what they wanted to accomplish, and asked if I would be willing to come. And I was delighted to say yes. Now, the instructions for this evening were quite specific. The first instruction was, this is not a memorial service. And I like that, because we don't want to drift that direction just yet. But they said it isn't a memorial service, but it is instead a service that we'd like to focus on legacy. In fact, Mike, I don't know if this is exactly true or not, but they said you were not really in favor of having this event if it was going to be the former, but you'd tolerate it if it was the latter. So I'm here tonight to talk a little bit about you, but mostly about legacy and the capacity we have as leaders to leave a meaningful legacy. And in order to do that, I'm going to speak from the premise upon which my book, Seasons of a Leader's Life, rests, and that is that there is a character in the Bible who is recorded living through all 3 of the major phases of a leader's life. Leaders are first learners, then they are leaders, and then they leave a legacy. And as I say in the book, these are not fixed segments of life. In other words, I'm a leader now for more than 40 years, and I'm still learning. You don't just learn and then lead and then leave a legacy. So you start out learning primarily, and then as time goes by, that becomes less and less, and you lead more and more. And even legacy leaving starts when you're a young person. Because there's things you need to get right when you're in the beginning phases of life and leadership that then will pay off those decades later when you're really leaving your so-called legacy. And so while there are these 3 phases, they aren't fixed segments. They are more like overlapping responsibilities and overlapping phases of life we live through. Who is this character in the Bible of which I speak? Well, it's the apostle named Peter. We're fortunate in that we have his learning years in the Gospels. Jesus came along and selected him, and for those 3 years that he was with Jesus, you might say he was in a combination spiritual boot camp and seminary experience and leadership practicum all at the same time. 3 years, he was primarily a learner. Then, in the book of Acts, we see Peter emerging as the leader. In very strong language in the first chapters, I'll talk more about in just a moment, Peter steps forward as the leader of the church in the book of Acts. And then we have something that we don't have really from any other character, and that is not only the learner phase and the leading phase, but then he wrote us his legacy. At the end of his life, he wrote little books we call 1st and 2nd Peter. And coincidentally, I'm in my reading, my Bible reading plan, my daily Bible reading plan, reading 1st and 2nd Peter this week. And so I'm reminded again of how this man wrote out at the end of his life what really mattered to him and left it for us really for all time. And so Peter is an example of a biblical character that lived through the three phases that I'm describing tonight. He was a learner in the Gospels. He was a leader in the book of Acts. He left his legacy in the letters he wrote at the end of his life. And I want to talk a little bit about each of these three phases tonight, using Peter's life as a backdrop, and then challenging us and moving us fairly quickly to the legacy portion of what I want to say this evening. The first phase of a leader's life is learning to lead. Now, Peter was not always a spiritual leader. You know, it's difficult when we know the end of the story to not read a story from the end back to the beginning. And so when we open up the first pages of the Gospels and see Peter being introduced to us, we tend to think of him as he ultimately came to be at the end of the writing of his letters and not recognize what it was really like when it first happened. Peter was no spiritual giant. He was a commercial fisherman. The Bible says in Luke chapter 5 that he had business partners and they owned multiple boats. This was not a man with a cane pole and a bobber sitting on a riverbank. This was a commercial fisherman who ran a business that provided a ready source of protein to villages around the Sea of Galilee that lacked refrigeration and the capacity for long-term food preservation. This was daily grind of work to provide a needed foodstuff for people in that community. But Jesus came along and called him to leave fishing and, in Jesus' words, fish for men. In that moment, in Luke chapter 5, Peter changed. Now, in John chapter 1, we read another aspect of the story that illustrates his change, and that is that he received a new identity in that Jesus even changed his name, giving him that name, Peter. You know, when you read through the Gospels, we see his identity changing, we see his role changing. But when we read through the Gospels, after those incidents where he's introduced to the concept of being the leader, when there's a list of the disciples, Peter's always first. Very quickly, he came to be recognized among his peers as the leader. He was setting the pace already early on in his life. Now, in a gathering like tonight, I think most of us in this room probably have some leadership responsibility. Many of you, for example, are called to lead. Some of you are called to lead other leaders, and a few of you will lead many leaders. Some, for example, are called to be kindergarten teachers. They have a classroom of 20, 25 children. They are responsible to lead in that classroom context. They are leaders. But a few are called to lead other leaders. They become the principal of the school that has the kindergarten teachers. A lot of other teachers, some additional staff, building support, all of those folk. Principals are leaders of leaders. But to continue the analogy, one person becomes the superintendent of schools, and they become the leader of many leaders. Now, it's easy tonight to say, well, I'm not in that third category, therefore I don't count. Well, that's underselling yourself and discounting God's placement of you in his role, in his kingdom, and the role that you have. You have some leadership responsibility. Receive that and fulfill it. And if you're one of those people who gets some additional responsibility to lead other leaders, take on that role. And if you're one of those that God asks to lead many leaders, humble yourself, watch yourself, and serve with everything you have in that capacity. Now, this leadership identity, this learning to lead and take on these roles and responsibilities and identities and callings as I've described them tonight, this is hard for some people to accept. A lot of reasons for that, I'll just mention them briefly. Some people have a false humility that says, well, I don't want to step forward and do that because I might be proudful in that moment. No, that's false humility. True humility is humbly doing what God asks you to do. Not saying I won't or I can't or I shouldn't, but stepping up and doing what God asks you to do. That's true humility. Some people don't want to learn to lead because they have an aversion to authority structures. They don't really want to be in charge of anything or have any weight resting on them. That leads us to a third reason. That's what I call the fear of responsibility. They just don't want the buck to stop at their desk. Someone asked me recently, when you retire, do you think you'll miss your work? I said, well, of course I will. They said, well, will there be parts of it that you won't miss? And I said, absolutely. In fact, I said, I really only want to retire from two things. The rest of it I'd like to keep doing until I die, but I'd like to retire from two things. Number one, I'd like to retire from going to anybody else's meetings. And number two, I'd like to retire from being responsible for anyone else's paycheck. We have 150 employees at Gateway Seminary, and I think about them a lot. And I think about how they're going to make their house payment and how they're going to put their kids through college and how they're going to take care of medical bills for unexpected crises that arise in their families. And while I realize that God is their ultimate supply, He expects me to write the checks. And I think about that a lot. It's a burden of responsibility. Some people don't want to learn to lead because they don't want that. And frankly, another reason is some people just simply feel inadequate and think that no way God could really use them. Well, enough about all that. All I'm trying to say is that there's a phase of life where you have to work through all these issues, where you have to learn to lead, where you have to get that new identity that Peter got when he got a new name and accept that new calling he got when Jesus called him off that fishing boat. And you have to step up and start learning what it means by putting yourself out there and being at the front of the line of those 12 disciples and being willing to be listed in that capacity and taking on a little bit of leadership and then a little more leadership and then sometimes a lot of leadership, perhaps, as you're learning what it means to lead, and you have to overcome all these false reasons for turning away from that responsibility. But then there comes a time when the learning gives way to the leading. Now, I've already said we're always learners. I get that. But when the learning gives way to the leading, leaders lead. One of the most gifted leaders I've ever known was a graduate of the Naval Academy, 17-year naval officer. God called him to pastoral ministry. He resigned his commission, went to seminary, earned 2 degrees, and pastored one church for about 30 years. Wonderful leader. He said to me one day, Jeff, do you know the first rule of command in the military? I said, no. He said, the first rule of command is, when placed in command, command. Leaders lead. Leaders are wired to improve things, to step forward and make things better, to take initiative when no one else seems to. Leaders lead. My oldest son is a leader. He's been a leader since his grade school days. When he was in kindergarten or first grade, we went for our first parent-teacher conference. We're sitting in those little chairs. You know how they make you do that? The teacher said, Mr. and Mrs. Orge, I've taught first grade in this room for 23 years. Let me tell you about your son. We got a little nervous. She said, he's the leader of our class, and he will be elected president of the student body when he's a senior in high school. And he was. When he was in the fifth grade in that same school, I went for parent-teacher conference one night. I'm standing in the hallway talking to Dan, the principal, when my son went speed walking by, and Dan said, "Casey." And I thought he was correcting him for walking too rapidly down the hallway. My son snapped his head around, "Yes, sir." And Dan said, "Check your box. There's some information in there you need for tomorrow." "Yes, sir." And around the corner he went. I turned to the principal and said, "Dan, my son has a box?" He said, "In the teacher's lounge." He said, "It's just better if your son knows what's going on. The school runs a lot better that way." Same son accompanied me to a speaking engagement one night, a little bit like this one, except it was a banquet. I arrived there, as I often do, didn't know a soul, invited by email, connected over the phone, but didn't really know anyone. Stood in the back looking over the crowd, trying to get my bearings of maybe who I needed to check in with or who I needed to see. And my little son was standing there beside me, and he's tugging on my jacket, kind of annoying me. I'm like, "What?" He said, "Who's the boss of this?" And I thought, "I don't know, but if we don't find out quickly, you're going to take over. Start organizing this thing." Leaders lead. They take command. They improve things. They step forward. They see chaos and they try to bring order. They see difficulty and they try to find solutions. Leaders lead. Now, in the first chapter of Acts, Peter took the lead in an unusual story that we often just rush past. We preach the Acts 1:8, go to the whole world and preach the gospel, then we skip over to chapter 2 and get right to Pentecost. But there's a great story at the end of Acts chapter 1 in which Peter does the first thing ever in the life of the church, and that is they select the replacement apostles, or apostle. There's one key phrase in that passage. It says, "He stood up." Do you know that there are 8 times in the book of Acts where the Bible says Peter stood up? Now, obviously, they're describing his physical movement. But don't you think 8 times is also trying to communicate something else to us? That he not only stood up physically, but he stood up and said, "I'll take the lead. I'll stand here. I'll do what needs to be done." And then it says in verse 16 of that same passage, he spoke up. And you can see throughout the book of Acts, Peter speaking up, preaching, speaking, counseling, consulting, offering direction. And when he offered that direction, he offered it based on 2 things. Verse 20 tells us he offered it based on Scripture, and verse 21, based on his experience as an apostle. And then they did that selection process. Put 2 options before them. They prayed, they cast lots, and they had a decision about who was going to be the replacement apostle. Listen, leaders lead. And that's what you've done. And we congratulate you both for doing so. And not just for a day or a night or a week or a month, but for a lifetime. You stood up. You spoke up. And you might not have always known what to do or been sure of what direction to go or always maybe known what needed to happen. But you were still willing to stand up and speak up and say, "Let's go forward together." Leaders take initiative and they assume responsibility for finding solutions. They inform their followers and involve them in decisions and solutions. They do like Peter did. They use the Bible to guide their decisions, but he also used his experience and perspective to guide decision making. And leaders guide in the implementation of ministry decisions for the good of the whole and to advance God's kingdom forward, not their own agenda. We've come to celebrate that tonight, and we thank you for your leadership. Learning to lead and leading. This presentation is going to take a turn now. I have the permission of the guest of honor and the organizer. Gateway Seminary commercial time. Before I move to the last part of my presentation on leaving a legacy, I want to say a word about recent events at Gateway Seminary. We were planning to have graduation in about 2 weeks. The COVID situation in California is very critical, and we are very sensitive at our school about how we're relating to all of those issues. And in a very difficult moment yesterday morning, I had to make the decision to cancel graduation. We simply can't have that many people in a facility and do it safely, and people would be traveling. Our school has students all over the world. People would be traveling, and it isn't going to work. So we made the decision to not have graduation. But you have a graduate here tonight, Jared Jenkins. And I want to tell you just a little bit about him, and then I want to say just a word about that. The highest award Gateway Seminary gives is called the William O. Cruz Presidential Leadership Award. The Cruz Award is given to students who show remarkable promise and opportunity for the future. We do not give it at every graduation. It's not mandatory. Sometimes I've given two at the same graduation, depending on the students involved. This is an award that recognizes someone that we believe has remarkable promise for future leadership in God's kingdom. Past awards winners are now on our faculty, serving as state executives in the western states, pastoring leading churches across our denomination, serving in leadership roles with the International Mission Board and the North American Mission Board. It is an award that recognizes someone because we believe they are not only doing something important now, but over the next two or three decades have the potential, because of their ability, their training, and their character, to make dramatic kingdom impact. And I am pleased tonight to announce that the William O. Cruz Presidential Leadership Award winner for this graduation is your friend, Jared Jenkins. Jared, would you come up here? You step right over here. The Cruz Award, let's get a photograph and I'll say just more about it, okay? Just stay right here with me for a second. The Cruz Award was named in honor of Dr. William O. Cruz, our sixth president who served for 18 years. When he passed away, he endowed this award and we named it in his honor. The award comes with this crystal eagle statue, which was a favorite symbol of Dr. Cruz and his family. It also comes with a generous cash gift. The check is in the mail. This arrived yesterday in our offices, and I decided to bring it here today, but I didn't get the check cut that quick. But you will get that in a few days. And typically, the guy gets the sculpture and the wife gets the check. So that's probably how it's going to play. But we congratulate you and honor you, brother, tonight. All right. Thank you so much. All right. Good. Thank you. Good. I just think that speaks to your humility as well to allow that to happen here tonight. Thank you so much. I know you have a relationship that goes back a number of years, and I'm glad it all worked out the way it did. I think that might have been even better than giving that to you in Ontario. So, okay, good. Well, let me conclude with just a few more comments about what it means to leave a legacy, all right? Leaving a legacy. First of all, what is a legacy? Well, there are some common definitions of legacy in our culture. First of all, a legacy can be defined by your record of achievements. For example, football coaches like to total up how many wins they've had in their career. We actually keep lists of that, the winningest coach in this conference or this school's history or this program or level of play. Teachers like to keep up with it. The number of students they've taught or the number of graduates they've had. For example, at Gateway Seminary, I keep up with the number of graduates we've had. And about this time next year, we're going to graduate our 10,000th student. And that's a significant achievement for us. And so in a sense, our school is leaving a legacy as we're getting closer and closer to those 10,000 graduates. Soldiers leave a legacy. They often wear a chest full of ribbons or medals or insignia that say where they've fought, what they've earned, where they've been, awards they've had given to them. Those are records of achievements for coaches and teachers and soldiers, and that's one kind of legacy. Here's another kind. Sometimes legacy is defined as a memorial record, like, for example, a statue on a campus. We have a very large and beautiful display at the campus in Ontario of the William O. Cruz Presidential Leadership Award. It has a photograph of Dr. Cruz. It has a rocking chair that he was given by the seminary upon his retirement. And it also has on the wall a list of all the past award winners, and they'll be there and as long as the seminary exists, as a memorial record, a legacy statement of what's happened. It's a plaque, a memorial, a statue, something that says, here's a legacy of what was accomplished. There's another kind of legacy. Some people consider a legacy to be the money they left behind. That's not a bad legacy. People give gifts and say that they want to name a museum or name a scholarship or help a school by giving a gift and sometimes a significant gift to make something happen. Our school has been the recipient of these, and we're grateful for them as people have left us legacy gifts to create a living, ongoing memorial about them moving forward in their lives. So some common definitions of legacy include a record of achievements, a memorial record, or perhaps money or gifts. Well, my definition, based on looking at what Peter did at the end of his life, is a little different. I believe legacy is this. Legacy is the wisdom you've gained, the people you've influenced, and the convictions you model which inspire a future generation. The wisdom you've gained, the people you've influenced, and the convictions you model which inspire a subsequent generation. Let's talk about each one of those three to close out tonight. First, your wisdom legacy includes the wisdom you've gained and how you, or your legacy includes the wisdom you've gained and how you share it with others. Three examples. You can share your wisdom legacy in letters. My friend Jim Higgs, a number of years ago, his wife's aunt, who's pushing up close to 90, in her late 70s, decided that she was going to master Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. She went to a community college and took a class in how to do social media. That's an old school way of learning it, but that's what she did. She told me, "All of my grandchildren communicate only by text and social media, and I will not be shut out of their lives." It became comical. She's a former school teacher. Every one of her social media posts was perfectly formed grammatically and with right punctuation. But that made them even more precious to her children and her grandchildren as they talked with each other and shared about the posts they received from their beloved grandmother. But my favorite example of a written legacy is actually something I didn't bring tonight because it's too precious to bring on a plane trip. My father-in-law died when my wife was 12. That was almost 10 years before we met and before we got married. He was a good and godly man, strong Christian, good father, died suddenly at age 39 of a heart attack. He was a basketball coach at a high school, 5'11", weighed 155 pounds. Just a sudden, catastrophic disaster in their family. No warning, no anything. Because of some family issues, most of his personal effects were lost over the subsequent years. But one thing was preserved, and it was handed eventually to my wife, and she and I have it in a very protected place today. It's her father's journal that he kept of his spiritual growth and development through college. Do you ever hear of a man named Jim Elliott who died a martyr's death? My father-in-law heard him speak in person on his college campus and has handwritten notes of his sermon outline. I could go on down the line of notes, insights, speakers he heard that are in this journal. And it's one of our most prized possessions because it is the wisdom of his legacy handed down to us, and the only thing we have left of him. Your wisdom, your legacy is first of all the wisdom you've gained and how you share it with others, whether it's by letters or social media or a journal or even just a conversation. People do care what you think. They do care what you've learned, and they do want to draw from you insight into how to live today. And then second, your legacy is the people you've influenced. It's leading people to Jesus and then serving others and impacting their lives. A few years ago, I led a very well-known professional athlete to faith in Jesus. It was a dramatic and powerful conversion moment, still effective these years later as he's continued to grow and to be discipled and to mature. And just this past week, had a text exchange with him about the book Shadow Christians, and he reminded me of how much his life has changed over these past 10 years. When I get to heaven, I'm not going to care about the budget I balanced or the buildings I built, but I am going to care about that guy who's in heaven with me and his wife with him because she came to faith soon after, and very likely his two boys come into faith when they get old enough. Leading people to Jesus is our people legacy, and beyond that, it's serving them and impacting their lives. I think about just two quick examples. One, a man named Larry, when I was right out of college, working my first church as a children's pastor, Larry was an engineer in his early days of his career, and he said to me one day, "I wonder if you could meet with me and just help disciple me and help me grow to be a better Christian." I said, "Me? Okay." We were two young guys, didn't have a clue, but he wanted me to help him, and I thought I could try. And so every Monday, he came to my office on his lunch break, and we got the food out of the daycare center that our church operated. I'm telling you what, we're living large on fish sticks and Ritz crackers. But anyway, we would get the whatever they served. We'd go in there and give them like a dollar, and we'd get the lunch, and we'd go in my office, and we'd 45 minutes of hardcore Bible study and discipleship while we ate the daycare lunch that we bought for a dollar. 4 or 5 years ago, Larry brought a mission team to the West, now these almost 40 years later. And he said, "Hey, listen, I just want to tell you one thing. You changed my life with those lunches 40 years ago. You taught me how to have a quiet time, how to study the Bible, how to memorize Scripture. You taught me how to pray, how to share my faith. Thank you for changing my life." But that's not my favorite story. My favorite story is this one. I was in my first pastorate. We reached a family that was hillbilly. They lived in a paperboard shack. They didn't have any walls. They just had felt paper stapled on 2x4s. They stole power off the power pole that went by their place where they put that shack up. We led them to faith in Jesus as a church. No exaggeration. First thing we had to do was teach them how to take a bath so they could come and sit in the service and we could take it. I'm not exaggerating. This is what it was like. That's who needs the Gospels, real people like that. They had 3 kids. The middle one was named Hazel. She was kind of a little bit chubby, a little mousy, kind of awkward. But she came to Sunday school, and she came to my wife's GA's class on Wednesday night, study missions. A few years go by. I left there and moved to the Northwest to plant the church, and we left this family behind. Planted the church, and a few years went by, and then I became state executive director, okay? And one day, a letter came in the mail addressed to us. And up in the corner, it said, "Hazel Miller." I said, "Ann, we got a letter from Hazel Miller. You remember that girl? Wasn't she in our church back in Missouri?" "Yeah, she was in our church. Yeah. We opened it up, and here's what it said. "Dear Ann, I'm graduating from Iowa State University in a few weeks with a degree in journalism. And I would like for you to come. And if you can't come, I'd just like for you to know that what gave me the confidence to go on to get this kind of education was what you did for me back in GAs when I was a little girl, that you taught me the gospel, taught me that there was more to life than I'd ever imagined, and showed me a world that was out there that I could be a part of. And now because of you, I'm graduating from Iowa State University. And I just wanted you to know that. My wife and I sat down and cried our eyes out that Hazel Miller came from a felt paper shack to the stage of the Iowa State University. That's a people legacy. You've got stories like that. People you led to faith in Jesus and held their hands while they figured out what life was all about and stood by them as they moved on forward in life. And they come around from time to time and you just smile because you know where they were and how far they've come. Your legacy is the wisdom you leave, the people you've impacted, and finally, the convictions you model. You've led by example, and you've led for long-term impact. The reason that people want you to be Pastor Emeritus is because you stand for something that means something to them and to this church. You've been leading by example for a long time, and you've led for long-term impact, and now you have the opportunity to finish strong and make that happen, that your impact will extend even into another generation. There's a photo hanging in my office in Ontario, California. It has the caption under it, the word legacy. Now, I've been at this a while. I'm 40 years now in ministry leadership. And so people often ask me, you know, what do you think your legacy will be? Is it the buildings you've built in the Northwest and in Ontario? Is it the church you planted? Is it the people you've impacted? Is it the books you've written? What do you consider your legacy? And I just always smile and say, well, it's right there in that photograph. That's the only legacy that matters at this point in my life. You know who's in that photograph? Four men, just four guys. My two sons, my son-in-law, and another young man who's been like a son to me. And what I tell people is this, when I'm dead and gone, if what I've done causes those four guys to live their lives in full devotion to Jesus so that their families get the benefit of that and their children have the opportunity to have the same kind of life if they choose it, my legacy will be secure. Because all I really care about at this point in my life is leading for long-term impact to leave behind some people who will carry on the convictions I've tried to model, the message I've tried to deliver, and the example I've tried to set. That's what really matters to me. And I want it to matter to you too tonight, and I know it does. So we learn to lead, and then we lead, and then we leave a legacy. And our legacy can be a lot of things, and those are things I mentioned at the beginning of this are not bad things. But I think we have a spiritual legacy that involves our wisdom, our people, and our convictions. And I thank God I'm here to celebrate those things tonight and to say thank you for a ministry well done, a life well lived, and the promise of further impact as you do this thing now called legacy leaving as the focus of your life in this next phase. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for letting me speak with you tonight.
Dr. Seafkow and I went to breakfast this morning. Took him up to Ruth's. Wasn't like what we know, because COVID meant that we had to eat in these greenhouse tents or something. But it was still good food. But we were talking about pastoring churches. And we drove away from that. We shared some stories. We talked through our situation. And I realized Josh and I are in a place right now, probably because we both have a good pastor emeritus that helps us see it. That's what I think it is. Where we get an opportunity to recognize the work that God is doing, and it's a very special opportunity that most people don't get to see. It's just you get this peephole, like you look in and you get to see all these things that nobody else ever knows. Pastor Mike has done such a good job of helping me see how God is working in things that look so insignificant to everyone else. And we were sharing stories, and I noticed that Josh's stories were similar in that, like, isn't this amazing? And anybody else would look at that and go, what? Right, well, okay, whatever. And so I just want to take just a moment to close here to see if I can share the glimpse in that I get to see right here in this moment, in this room. And I hope it's not lost on you. I hope you get a chance to see it too. I'm going to start with Dr. Orch. He's going to be an illustration, and I have the utmost respect for you. You are my hero, so in no way do I want this to come across as offensive. It's a compliment. However, the reason that many of us in this room appreciate Dr. Orch, the reason that Josh came out to go to school in California, and the reason that I hear this over and over and over again, has to do with this thing that I see in Mike too. This morning, I mean, Jared and I had a phone call, and once again, Jared said, that man, because he had met with Dr. Orch for a meeting today, said, that man's a real deal. I can't tell you how many times I've heard that. I can't tell you how many times I've said that. And yet, when you look nationwide, this is where I don't mean to be offensive, but you look nationwide, here's a man who is not making a kingdom of his name. Probably not selling as many books necessarily as some of the other seminary presidents. Not trying to pick on anybody, but probably not as well known in some circles. Well sought out. But here's the thing, and I want to show you, and this is what people fail to understand. If you would do me a favor in this room, and the people online, I'm sorry, I'm just going to try to explain what we see. If you have been a student and you have benefited in your ministry because of Gateway Seminary, please stand up. Dr. Clements, Dr. Seafkow, Dr. Jenkins, Mike Pless, myself, I'm standing as well. Nobody probably really, if you guys can sit down, thank you. Nobody probably realizes the impact of the work that Gateway, many of us, I think all of us in this room went there when it was Golden Gate at one point, right? But you don't realize the impact of faithful service to train leaders, to equip ministers to do the work. It's not seen in the world as some big sexy thing. It's not the most sought after, but it is a direct representation of the leadership and the attitude and the care for the kingdom first, and all the rest can fall where it falls. And that's because of Dr. Jeff Orch. So thank you for that. But I share that as an illustration, because what most of you don't see, because of the same sort of humility, is what's happened in this community because of Pastor Mike and his wife. Don't miss that. The pastor's wife usually works harder than the pastor, right? Sometimes, she says. We can point to things in the past that we can physically see, like this building. Pastor Mike moved the church from Five Points to this building and oversaw that. We can look at pictures, and I've been looking at some as we've merged, where we see huge VBSs and amazing, remarkable things in the past that are easy to see. But what you don't see is something we heard a little bit when Jared was up here. Pastor Mike knew Jared when Jared was 18. Pastor Mike was an example to Jared for what Christians live like in Utah when Jared was 18. And we all know what it's like when you're 18, right? I think Jared would agree. I feel this way getting, and I've known you for 12 years, I think. I was trying to do the math, 11 or 12 years. There's something to be said about seeing somebody in the saddle just riding it out day in and day out, in a place that nobody goes, hey, that's the big church we need to look to. That's the big name. Nobody's running to Pastor Mike and saying, write a book. However, the list of people that I've met that have been impacted by you, including other pastors in this room, there's one sitting over there that has told me he is so thankful for you. One over here. We have denominational guys. We have people in this community who have been impacted by the faithful work that has happened here, and you never got an award, and you never got a trophy, and the church never knew. They didn't know the denominational work you do. They didn't know the care. And I think it's important that people have an opportunity to understand that, just like the illustration I gave you with Gateway, the same thing has been happening here, and I believe will continue to happen here. So now, this is just mostly for Redeeming Life, but I want you to see this too. Because Pastor Mike deviated from his plan, in fact, this church's plan, to hire somebody, train him up, Mike would ride off into the sunset, that person would take over in the ministry. Pastor Mike said, God is doing something different. What is it? I want you guys to see something else, because this is why Pastor Mike is going to remain with us for some time as a pastor emeritus. I said at the beginning, he meets with some of the older folks. He's going to preach once in a while, but if if we could do this, there are some young men in the room that are a part of Redeeming Life. I'm going to pick on maybe three of them specifically, but two of them we've just brought on our staff. So Josiah's standing back there in the sound booth. Raise your hand back there, Josiah. He's like, I'm supposed to be hidden in the shadows back here, and you're calling me out. We brought him on. We don't pay him because he's got a great job, but just kind of is. Sorry, man. And we just hired Robbie. Stand up for us real quick, Robbie. And Patrick's back there. We think there's a lot of potential here in this man, too. There's some others of you in the room, but we've specifically said, what can we do that will outlast us with the time we have right now? I don't know if it's these guys. We'll see what God does, and I hope it's many others, but I want you to remember that our focus, you guys can sit down, are guys like that. And Pastor Mike now has an opportunity to take all the wisdom of all the years, all the hits, all the challenges, all the victories, and take all of that and say, I'm going to give that away to people who will be here after I'm long gone and forgotten. I hope to do the same. But church, I hope that you will join us in helping this man accomplish those things for the kingdom. And that is exactly why we have him remaining with us and not riding off into the sunset as our pastor emeritus. And I'm honored to be on that journey with you. I just want to pray. Yeah, let's thank you. Thank you. I want to make sure that you have a little bit of time to chat with him. So we'll just put you out there and let everybody talk with you as they're making their way wherever they're headed. But I would like to just pray for you right now, if I may. If I can do that. And if you guys would join me, I just want to pray. God, it is an amazing thing that you are doing. And we don't even know the half of it. You have planted seeds, maybe seeds in Jared when he was 18. Who knows? You've used Pastor Mike's life in such a way to do things that we are only now starting to see just the fruit of some of those things. God, I pray that you would give him great longevity to continue serving in this way, to plant just the right seeds that will produce such good fruit for your kingdom, to help equip leaders, to help walk with people who just need that kind of wisdom, to continue to be an encouragement, even if it's an encouragement that someone else might live their life in just such a way, or structure their Christian journey in just such a way, because they saw Mike Pless do it. God, I ask that you would bless him in that, and that you would give him many more years to leave a legacy that no one will point to Mike Pless about, but they'll point to Jesus. God, give him the opportunity to lead many more to salvation, to disciple more. God, give him the wisdom to continue to help me as I'm trying to lead a church. Lord, I just ask that that legacy for your kingdom would be grand in a place where people tend to overlook and they don't seem to think about what's happening here. God, you've done this work, and we ask that you would continue to do it in remarkable ways. Lord, I thank you, and we give thanks for long ministry by a faithful man in an incredibly challenging place. And that is, Lord, why we gather here tonight. So I just ask that he would be blessed and that he would know at least our gratitude, but more importantly, Lord, he would know your view of him. And I know that you are pleased with his faithfulness. So God, bless him and his continued ministry. Bless the remainder of our evening just as we fellowship with him. God, I just pray that many years from now, people would look back and go, you remember Mike? Wow, that guy changed my life. God, we are thankful for him. And it is in Jesus' name we give thanks. Amen. At this time, I'm just going to let you mingle about, but I want to encourage, because I have to encourage, that you stay safe. You know, do the elbow or fist bump thing. Just don't go give Mike hugs. He's a hugging handshake kind of guy, but we want to be safe here. We don't want to have any issues. Please wear your mask and feel free to socialize in that way. Thank you guys for coming out. If you're watching online, thank you. I hope this has been just a joy for you. You guys are dismissed.